Good evening once again, and welcome to our today's session on anxiety defense mechanisms. Today, to talk to us and to help us understand the intensity and to how we can overcome this problem, we have Rachel Jayasiddhan. She's currently pursuing her doctorate in psychology. She's graduated in master's in clinical psychology and MPhil from Christ University, Bangalore. Her internship, study, and publication experiences are in the area of oncology, relationships, study, publication, experiences are, and addiction. Her work is currently in the domain of development of assessments as part of her research. She has been working at Christ University, Bangalore in the Department of Psychology, teaching assessments, supervisors, cases for clinical counseling psychology and education psychology. Rachel has been certified in NLP, cognitive analytic therapy, and master level hypnosis. She follows a eclectic approach to counseling, which has helped maximize benefits towards her clients. With respect to practice in particular, she consults specially for psychological and educational assessments at Reach Clinic, Bangalore. She's currently and working with close to 900 clients from the past 3 years. Her area of expertise is screening and diagnostic testing for developmental delays, LD, ADHD, behavioral and emotional disorders in children. She's conducted more than 50 workshops for students on a variety of topics such as effective communication skills, decision-making strategies, dealing with anxiety, depression, and healthy interpersonal relationships. So we are so much delighted to have Rachel to talk to us this evening. And there's so much fits into the time, such as COVID-19 with this lockdown. I'm sure the statistics this year, and especially during this time, has increased. So thank you everyone for joining, and especially thank Rachel Jayasiddhan for taking time to address us on this immediate need that all of us, our neighbors, people around us are facing. Over to you, Rachel.
Thank you so much. It's a pleasure to be here and to interact with all of you. So before we get into the discussion or into the topic, I would really encourage you to use the chat option which is given below on your screen. And if there are any questions, you can send it across to me as well. And I would take them at the end of the small talk that we could have about anxiety. So to begin with, recently, we have had a huge spike in the number of clients or the number of people that we are starting to work with, especially with relation to mood-related disorders or mood-related issues, namely anxiety and depression. So today's talk would be about anxiety. And to begin with, I would like you to understand what anxiety itself is. Most of us would have experienced it at some point of time in our lives. But also we need to understand when it becomes when does it become an actual concern. So anxiety is a normal reaction to stress. And some amount of anxiety is expected and it's normal. And we need it to function in life. Okay, for example, if my students are not anxious about the exams, they are not going to prepare for it. And if you're not anxious about the traffic in Bangalore, you would not prepare ahead and start at the right time in order to reach work. So optimum, some amount of anxiety is necessary for us to function in our day-to-day life. And usually anxiety comes up in response to a stressor. An exam or a promotion, job employment, a relationship beginning or an ending. So there is a stressor. However, when does anxiety become a cause of concern is when even after the stressor is gone, if the anxiety continues to last, then it becomes an issue of concern. Okay, which means that let's say after the exam is done and I still continue to feel anxious even though the exam is over, or if my anxiety is not only with relation to say I talked to you about say the traffic or a relationship, once the stressor is over, if I still feel anxious, then it's a cause of concern. So some of the symptoms that you can experience in the case of anxiety is repetitive thoughts, worrying thoughts, such where you anticipate the worst in a situation, right? So for example, if you are having job related anxiety, you would have thoughts such as, what if I don't get a job? What if I don't ever get employed? Or what if I get into a financial crisis? What if I will not be able to support my family because I don't get a job? So these what if statements keep coming up, and it will always be in where you anticipate the worst outcome. You fear the worst situation, that is anxiety. You can also have frequent bouts of irritability where small interactions at home can trigger your anxiety, right? Can trigger irritability. Your mom or your a relative, a family member can tell you, keep this here, do that there, something which is very normal, but you start to get very irritated and triggered for that. It means that you're already feeling vulnerable and something is pushing you over the edge. Now, anxiety is not something that we are very conscious about. It always works at a subconscious level. So a lot of times we don't understand that it's happening to us. And that is why people feel uneasy. They feel that something is going wrong, but they don't know what. And the first things that starts getting interrupted is sleep cycle, where you find it difficult to go to sleep, or you find it difficult to stay asleep. And something else that can come up is difficulty in focusing, difficulty in concentrating. It can also happen. And you would also start to experience some physical symptoms. This could be headaches, body aches, and in an extreme state, it could also lead to states of panic where you feel that things are not under your control, and we start to fear uncertainty. Now, this is how anxiety usually presents. And like I told you, some amount of anxiety is normal and it is needed for us to function. It is only when it starts extending, it becomes all-encompassing and it starts enveloping all areas of our life, that is when we say that the anxiety is a cause of concern. And it affects both the body as well as the mind, the physical as well as the mental, both. Now, what we are right now, depending upon the different age groups that we are in, the different careers that we are involved in, it can be gender related, but anxieties can even vary as to what we are anxious about. Okay. For example, just yesterday, I gave a talk to college students who are in their final year, who are all experiencing job related anxiety. And then when I work with some of my clients who are having relationship difficulties, they have anxiety related to whether or not this relationship will survive the lockdown, right? Where we worry, there's constant worrying and brooding in the case of anxiety, and sleep disruptions are quite common in that case. Right now, what are the ways in which people have been reacting to this anxiety, right? Most of us, initially, we might tend to avoid dealing with the anxiety, or we would try the coping strategies that we have used before. And only when it doesn't work, do we start to panic. But usually, if you have had effective coping strategies, it would have worked. Okay, so I would like to quickly differentiate a couple of the strategies that people most likely use, and also emphasize the kind of strategies that are not, that have not seen to be very functional. Okay. The first one is avoidance, right? Avoidance can be in the context of where you don't deal with your anxiety itself, or it could be, distraction, but the anxiety is still there and you try to distract yourself temporarily through other strategies. And it can also be, like I mentioned, avoidance is one, distraction is another. In avoidance itself, it could be avoiding talking to someone about the anxiety, right? Let's say a person does have an anxiety about getting a job, but they don't talk about it. They keep it to themselves. They keep thinking about it. They spend more time thinking about it than actually doing some work, such as searching for a job. There is more thoughts related to it. That's when we know it's dysfunctional. Yet another strategy that people use is maladaptive coping methods, such as projection, right? Where you project your anxiety onto something else. Let's say we know that we are feeling anxious in one particular situation, but then let's say that we are anxious about getting a job, but we project it on to something else, such as saying that we are not getting a job because the job market is not too good, or we're not getting a job because there are too many people fighting for a job right now. So we put the blame on something external so that we don't have to feel the responsibility at any point of time. That's also one of the strategies that is commonly seen with individuals who are experiencing anxiety. We also have displacement, which is when I'm feeling anxious, instead of dealing with my anxiety, I tend to show my irritation, frustration, my negative emotions on something else, right? Not on the actual cause of my anxiety, maybe because I can't. And then I show it on someone, something which I can, right? So here is when something simple could be being stressed at work or because of work, and then coming and taking that irritability out on your spouse or on your children or on your friends at in a conversation. That is displacement. It's an unhealthy passing down of the energy. Now, so when I say distractions, okay, this could also be, especially in youngsters, there could be increased use of substances. Like alcohol use is something which is commonly seen, where they feel that when they are under the effect of certain substances, they're not able to experience an emotion. A negative emotion is numbed, whereas a positive emotion will be heightened. That's how the substances actually work. So when they have substances, it's a different method of distracting themselves from having to face reality, right? So that is one of the strategies that is seen. Now, we also can have productive methods, right? Which is using your anxiety and doing something productive with that energy that you have inside you, right? Some people, when they feel most anxious, they tend to exercise. Some individuals, when they feel more anxious, they listen to some music. They tend to put their energy, or they sing. So I have a friend actually who, to overcome her anxiety, she has actually started taking music classes so that she gets over her fear of, or her anxiety about performance, right? Performance anxiety is something which is also seen in a child population, where in the clinic where I work, a lot of times I get children who say that the parents will say that the child studies really well and tells everything at home, finishes all the worksheets at home. However, when they go to the exam, their papers might be blank or they blank out. And more so ever in math papers, this is generally seen. So you can see how much a fear about something prevents optimum performance, right? Where worrying about something stops you from actually taking action about it. And so these are some of the strategies that are also used. Now, people generally tend to feel more anxious when they focus on things which they are not able to control in their lives. Okay, for example, right now, we are going through the COVID lockdown, and the type of stressors which are operating in our lives are completely different. It's not something we are used to, In other words, right now, we are dealing more with the unknown than the known, right? And even in that, there are a lot of factors that we can't control. We can't control how many days we are going to be in the lockdown. We can't control the economy. We can't control the prices of items in the market, the availability of items in the market. We will not be able to control whether we are able, we have a job or not. And neither our income, we can control to some extent, but if you're employed, say full-time in a company which decides to make you work for the same number of hours for half the pay, which a lot of companies are going through right now. Now, these are things which you can't control. You can't even control the number of deaths, the number of people getting infected with the COVID. These are things that you can't control. But these are also the things that people are increasingly focusing on and they're getting anxious about, right? So the more you focus on things that you can't control, the more you are going to get anxious. And of late, it has been disrupting a lot of people's daily routines, daily productivity. And this is where I also want to emphasize on the structure of our culture, right? Or structure of our society. Right from childhood, we are always told that we need to be productive, right? We don't allow children to laze. Girl children are taught skills, boy children are asked to go out and play. We have to constantly be productive. At the same time, parents also, when the child is not doing anything, right from a young age, we're pushed to a whole number of classes and we always have to keep being productive, right? And we are also in a society where we look down upon people who are not employed, who are not doing anything useful with their lives. We label them. This is how the stereotypical view of the society is. So come the lockdown, when we suddenly got cut off from 10 to 12 hours of productive work, of structured work, to sitting at home, right? People started feeling very guilty about not being productive. They started feeling anxious because this is a state that they did not recognize. This is a situation which is very unknown to them. And in a state of the unknown, there is always fear. It is like telling a person, let's say, if I travel to any place within South India, I generally feel more comfortable because I know the language and I have relatives in a lot of places in South India. This is some kind of a connection. However, if I am told by myself to travel to, say, a place in the north, right, where it's a predominantly Hindi-speaking society, then I know that I would be very uncomfortable and I would be anxious about that situation. Now, that's all right because it is very specific to that situation, that any other time I would not have the anxiety. Once the trip is over, I would not have the anxiety. But in the extreme cases, like in the case of anxiety disorders is what we call it, the anxiety is prevalent. It is present in all domains of your life. Okay, for example, we have something called as generalized anxiety, where just because of who you are, how you are as a person, you're anxious about everything. Right? You might be anxious about your work life, your personal life, your social life. If not one, you're constantly thinking about something else. That is a state of generalized anxiety. We also have social anxiety, where some people keep away from social situations because they fear being judged. They fear a state of discomfort in the situation. I spoke to you about performance-related anxiety, which it's in the point of where you might be judged by someone else, you are more prone to this. Now, in the case of anxiety, who are more vulnerable to get it? Who are more vulnerable to reacting to a situation in a more anxious manner? The first thing is genetics. Heredity plays a strong role in this, where let's say that you have been brought up in an environment where your parents are constantly anxious, right? They don't let you go out, or you're not exposed, you don't have a lot of experiences, and there might be a lot of phone calls if you miss the deadline or you come back home a little late. If, let's say, you have a small wound, it's made, they constantly worry about it. Children learn by when people model a particular behavior, right? And the first 8 years of life is very impactful for a child. That is when they are learning the most. So what parents do with a child in the first 8 years of life, it impacts the child a lot while growing up, right? About how a child deals with a known situation or an unknown situation. So in the initial years, learned behavior is a lot. Okay. For example, in my family, for example, when there is any situation which creates anxiety, I have always been brought up seeing my mom and my mother and my grandmother pray as the first option when there is a state of anxiety. They would always pray. And I have seen that. And I have been brought up in that kind of an environment, so that when even I feel anxious right now, I would either, when it's overwhelming, I would either call them to pray or I would say a quick prayer by myself, because it's learned. And it's learned in the early years. And that is strongly imbibed in your brain. Whereas, let's say, families where when there is anxiety about something and the family members or your caretakers react with anger and irritation, that is what the child will also learn. That, or when certain emotions are not discussed. Okay, for example, I mentioned that in our culture, productivity is always rewarded. The second thing is, in our families, we do not discuss negative emotions. We are more than happy to pat our children on their backs when they succeed in something, when they get a gold medal. For some parents, at least if the child passes an exam, and we are more comfortable talking about the positive emotions than the negative emotions. We do not want to tell anybody that you're feeling anxious. More so, there is gender differences here, where we feel that we are more open to accepting weaknesses from women than men. This is also very strongly prevalent in our society. So even now, when I see, say, the client base that I work with, majority would be women, right? Men come to us only when, you know, that some anxiety or depression is preventing them from something which is very important. That is when they come, even though they have been dealing with this particular issue for a long period of time. Okay, so moving forward, let's also, I would like to talk about a couple of things that can be done in order to feel that things in your life are actually more under your control, right? Anxiety is a state where you feel like you don't know where things are going and you anticipate the worst in situations, right? And it's a constant thoughts, constant worrying. And we also spoke about how there could be negative strategies such as avoidance. Some people live in denial, right? Where they'll rather not talk about it or ignore that event has actually happened, because that stops you from experiencing that anxiety. There could also be projection, where instead of taking responsibility for something, we tend to blame something external. All of this is very maladaptive coping mechanisms. And in extreme case, where you do not even want to psychologically deal with it, sometimes you will experience a lot of physical symptoms, right? I talked about like headaches, backaches, body aches. These are all very common when they don't, or when they want to avoid dealing with the psychological anxiety. The adaptive strategies, things that you can do, right, instead of all these maladaptive strategies. The first thing is, one is, you need to have a structure when it comes to your routines. Okay, for example, we've seen that a lot of people tend to do this overthinking when lying on their beds at night. That is when all the work that has distracted them throughout the day actually is done with, and they have all the time in the world now to sit and brood and think about what will happen, what if this doesn't happen, what if this doesn't happen, etc. So the first thing is the bed needs to stop being associated with worrisome thoughts, which means you do not lie down on the bed until and unless you're absolutely sleepy. You want to think, you want to overthink, you do it anywhere else, but your sleep routines needs to be in place, right? And a lot of people use religion as a healthy way of coping. So when you find that a person is very religious, they have a strong spiritual life, then that is something that you can use to help them understand or cope better with their anxiety. That praying can help, finding comfort in their religious texts, that can also work. And another thing is, whenever you have anxious thoughts, it's important that it is not, it does not remain in your head as thoughts, right? As long as it's there as thoughts, it is very dangerous, because inside your head, it is free floating energy. One thought can become another thought in another 2 minutes that it exists inside your head. Okay. I'll give you an example for this. So I was recently working with this girl about 26 years of age, and she had a lot of anxiety that her partner would leave her, and she was constantly worried that she would be abandoned in her relationship. And when we explored that further, her anxiety was almost there throughout the day. She would feel that something is going wrong, something is going to go wrong for sure. And these kind of thought processes were always there, and it was preventing her from working. She would be working, and she would constantly check her phone, waiting for bad news. Or even if her partner would say something which is very trivial, she would jump on that and say, see, this means that you are going to leave me. Constant vigilance, alertness is also a state of anxiety. Now this girl, when I inquired with her, she was talking about how she feels that this person might abandon her because she doesn't look really good, and that the person might move on to someone better. Now, what I need to focus on here is that this girl is actually extremely good looking. She's extremely good looking, and she's a fitness trainer. So for me, I may not be able to understand exactly what thought process is going on in her head initially, but in conversation, she was telling me that when she was in the third standard, her teacher, they had a play going on in school, and she wanted to be the butterfly. And her teacher told her that, no, we want to put this girl in the as a butterfly. She would look more beautiful. Now that happened in third grade. Okay. And then when she was in 10th standard, she remembers an incident where one of her friends or close friends, who's a boy, started becoming friends with someone else, right? Which could have been for varying different reasons. But the thought for her came from third standard that there I was not chosen because I was not looking good enough. So must be that reason now. That is fast forward to 10th standard. And then moving forward, now she's 27 years old. All the thoughts are free floating, right? Memories connect so that we make sense of it. In fact, they call men as human beings are meaning making machines. We always try to make meaning out of something which is there in our lives. Otherwise we'll go crazy. Something has to make sense, right? It's including I usually say that when my mom asks my brother, how was your day? He will say, okay. And she will go crazy because she wants to know more. Okay is not enough of an answer for her. We want to know. We are curious as human beings. We want to have an answer, right? So anxiety is like dealing with the unknown. So when we only have thoughts, right? As children, it's important that parents have the kind of relationship with their children that children are able to come and discuss their worries with them, and parents give the correct kind of validation for their children, which is not always possible because nobody is a perfect parent. But while growing up, we have various experiences. If we constantly have negative experiences, low self-esteem is something which is very possible, right? Even the prettiest of girls, even the most handsomest of boys can grow up feeling that they look awful. It's completely possible, right? So when you have anxious thoughts about anything, about your future, about the past, about things which are happening today, do not keep them as thoughts. It's important that you write them down. When you write them down, you know it's concrete. It's there on paper. It can't become anything else unless you write it. So if you have a thought process before it can develop into something else, it's important that you write it. Also, we sometimes tend to lose touch with reality itself, with the amount of thoughts that are going, the masala which is there inside our heads. You know, so many thoughts can actually happen. In fact, when I deal with clients who have this condition called as mania, right, I can see the speed at which they are thinking. You know, before I say one sentence, they would have 10 thoughts, all unrelated to the other, but it is there. So it's possible. And that's the capacity of the human mind to be able to think. And in the case of anxiety, we are only anticipating the worst situation, right? So I would always encourage people saying that if you're anticipating the worst situation, you have a backup for the worst situation already. So that if it happens also, you have a backup instead of only worrying what will happen if that worst situation happens. Okay, for example, if you fear that you are not going to get a job, have a backup. If you don't get a job, what can you do? You know that you have to plan your budget properly, or you might have to take a loan, or you might have to get help from friends or family. Keep that in place rather than only sitting and thinking, because when you're thinking, you're not really acting. Okay, so before we wind up and then start taking questions, I just want to project something here. Just a second. Right. So I hope you're able to see this here, where I've labeled something as how do you gain control with your life again, right? There are three conditions that I have placed there. One is how do you improve who you are as a person? Second is how do you improve the worth that you have as a person? And how do you improve the sense of stability? Now, the third thing is right now we feel that things are just completely unstable. One day government announces lockdown, next day no lockdown. One day classes for your kids, next day no classes for the kids. It appears unstable, right? And we feel that there are aspects of our life where there is no control. But in this table here, I have jotted down a few things where everything here is actually under your control and you can do it. And the more you realize that, say, even with respect to not having a job, right? We can look for opportunities. We can connect with people. We can take an online course, improve our resume, try and earn money online. We can affiliate with an NGO and try to do some work, gain some experience. There are so many things that you can actually do to deal with that anxiety related to a job. Right. In fact, recently, one of my clients who was going through job related anxiety. She said that at least I asked her to give me a schedule about how she spends her day. She actually approached me for job related anxiety. She was afraid. What if she doesn't get employed? Because as per social media, all of her friends were getting employed and she was feeling left behind. So when she gave me her schedule, most of her day goes in sleeping and most of her awake time goes in worrying about not getting a job. So in every day, she would spend about half an hour maximum searching for a job, right? And then the worry would be there for the rest of the day. So you could see how encompassing it can actually be. By sleeping also, we tend to avoid. Even in the case of depression, for example, when they tend to sleep a lot, it's a tendency to, you know, they're trying to go over their day so that they don't have to be awake and alert and experience the negative emotions. So these are some things that you can actually do. Now, COVID-related anxiety was on the rise in the initial phase of the lockdown. And I would also ask the same people how much time they actually spent on their phones. How much time they actually spend forwarding messages related to the virus. I'm pretty sure more than the WHO itself, there were people here, Indians, who were forwarding messages, right? My mom used to send me at least 100 minimum messages a day, which would clog up my entire phone. Okay, this preoccupation with something is it's like it's another way for us to try and gain control. We think by doing something many number of times that we have control over it. But actually what's happening is we are getting more anxious. The more we converse with people about the things that are going downhill right now, the more anxious you are going to feel. So instead of being reactive, only reacting with either anxiety or low mood or anger or irritability, it's important that you are proactive, right? Not being reactive, but being proactive. Yes, the anxiety is there. Accept it, acknowledge it, write about it, and then see what can I do about it. I'm worrying about my job. What can I do? I'm worrying about my relationship. What can I do? So start getting into a proactive role. In fact, with families, this particular grid which I put up, this is something that families can actually do together, right? This concept of a bingo is actually becoming very popular nowadays. So this is something that together as a family can achieve, where you're kept active throughout the day. If you want to sleep during the daytime, that is also fine. You don't have to feel guilty about not being productive. But there are healthy ways in which you can deal with your anxiety, right? Where you could fill up that void that you have, fill up that guilt that you have. Instead of that guilt, replace it with something more positive, positive energies. Okay, so the more time that you spend with family, there are different things that we find comforting. For some people, it can be food. For some people, it can be family. For some people, it can be spending time in prayer. It can be going for a walk, taking a long shower. So it's important that we find that space where we give ourselves some amount of compassion and love also. So it's not only about always others, but we don't have to be harsh to ourselves when we feel weak. Okay, it's not a weakness. It's just that we have not experienced it before, and that's all right. Okay, so if you have any questions, please leave it in the chat and I'll be more than happy to answer it for you. If there are any questions.
Rachel, maybe I'll ask the first question.
Yeah, sure.
As parents, how do we inculcate the habit in children to express such negative, anxious thoughts or emotions?
Okay. So the first thing is when parents themselves have to be comfortable in expressing to their children, which never happens, right? We feel we don't really speak about emotions at home, and children learn when they see. So for example, if a wife tells her husband that I'm a little worried about work, right? But and then the husband responds by saying, you can do this instead. Is this something that you could do? Or they can see the parents engaging in a healthy discussion. Then there also is a room for them to express their emotions. So the first thing is you need to model the behavior rather than just expecting it from the children. And the second thing is when you encourage the child to express, and the child does express, right? Children sometimes find it difficult to put their emotions into words, right? So with the younger children, we usually use these smileys, no? At the end of the day, when they come back from school, we show them the chart and we ask them, how do you feel today? Which has a happy face, still an angry face, to a sad face. And children can relate to that. They all read books, see Cartoon Network, all of that. So that's something that you could do. And when they are able to show that they're experiencing a particular emotion, children, you need to give them patience to voice out, right? As adults, we don't have the patience when children are trying to find the right words, and they are definitely not as smart as us, okay? So, or do not have enough vocabulary as us. And when a child is trying to say something, I often see, like even in the clinic, when I'm trying to talk to a child, the parents will complete the sentence for the child, right? How is school today? School is, tell ma'am about this, you know, tell ma'am about something. We will not let the child complete what they are feeling. That's very important. You and give them the space have a lot of patience when it comes to that. And even if they show you a negative emotion, there should not be any judgments. Children always fear from a young age that if they feel something that they shouldn't, and if they say something that they think is wrong, that they will be punished for it, or that they will not get the validation from their parents for it. And they often cut off because of that. Another strong influence is in school, right? Now, the school is somewhere parents don't have a huge, school is where parents are actually cut off from the child. That's a time that the child spends with his or her peer groups. Now, let's say there itself, the child feels a little scared, feels a little worried about something. Math is making him feel anxious. He's not going to show that in school, right? Bullying is on the rise. And I've had a lot of cases where even the smartest of kids are made to feel dumb because their children, their peer groups are a little bit smarter in terms of maybe marks, right? So they have that fear when it comes to peer pressure. So the home is the safest place that they can express an emotion, right? And it's also possible for parents, we know our children so well, that you can anticipate how they feel. It's always important to discuss it before they go into that situation. Right. For example, let's say a big exam is coming. You think you know that the child is not able to get all the sums correct, for example. So you could anticipate that anxiety or worry is going to be a possibility and already talk to your child about it by saying, because of the exams that is coming, are you feeling a little worried? You might be feeling a little worried and that is okay. We are not expecting you to get all the sums right. You do the best that you can. If you're worried also, you tell mama, that's okay. We can pray about it or we can talk about it. I will help you out with a few more sums. So you should make them feel safe rather than telling, how many ever times I teach you, you will not learn. One small statement like that, I have found that children, they hold on to small things that parents have accidentally said in a state of anger and in a state of frustration, and it impacts the child a lot because a child is actually what we call as a blank slate when they are born. Everything that is put into them is written, right? Reactions of parents teaches them how to be. Parents, teachers, friends, it all teaches them how to be. And that is something that you can actually do with children. Give them a safe space to explore any emotion. I hope I've answered that.
There is a follow-up question to this.
Okay.
So one of the participants is asking, as you said, up to 8 years of a child is very impacting. How do you deal with your child's anxiety once that age has passed? So she's asking, above 8 years, how do you deal?
Above 8 years. I would say that as long as with Indian parents, especially, no matter how old we get, children are children. And it has to be dealt with in the same way. That is, however old the child should be comfortable expressing any emotion at home, right? I've had some wonderful parents also who come and tell me that, ma'am, even if he fails, even if he hits someone, he will come and tell me, right? That lack of fear is important. Where do children learn fear from? If you actually, when I say anxiety is fear of the worst outcome, right? Where do they learn fear? Where do children learn fear? They learn it at home. They learn from punishments. They learn from getting hurt. They learn from when they put their hand into an electric plug or fire and they get burnt. They learn fear. Okay, it's not told to fear, right? So our reactions matter a lot. I would say well into adolescence, you need to create that safe space. And after some time, as they get into adolescence, children will start looking for validation, not only from parents, but also from their peer groups, right? So it's important as parents, you don't have to be over involved in your child's life, but you should also give that space for your child to come to you, right? And some things, it's important that they learn on their own 2 feet, right? We can't also spoon feed them forever. So even after the age of 8, as they move into adolescence, create a safe space. It's important for parents also to be as open as they can with their children because they are expecting that from their children, right? So let's say, for example, your 10-year-old child and you are sitting for dinner together. It's important that not only you ask your child, how was your day? but you should also share, right? You should also share and tell the child, you know, today this is something which has happened and I felt a little bad, but blah, blah, it's okay. I thought we could do this. We should never, it's not that we're asking them for a solution, but small things like sharing, right? Even if it's, this is making me angry, we usually react than speak, right? We react with anger rather than telling the boy or the girl that we are angry, right? We always react, and children fear the reaction. They don't fear the conversation, right? So that goes up into older years as well. So we have a couple more questions. How do you help your client connect ache or body ache with anxiety? Okay. So if the body aches are all in only in the time period that you are experiencing anxiety, then you know that if the stressor is not there and you're still starting to experience anxiety. Now, usually anxiety becomes body symptoms only in when you're not dealing with it properly or healthily in an actual manner, that is in a psychological manner, you're not dealing with it, then it can translate to body aches, right? Now, that is something we call as somatic anxiety. It becomes physical and it's not caused actually because of any body ache per se, but it's psychological stress that is felt. For example, I'm sure all of us would have had, you know, stress headaches, we call it. That is not actual headaches as how it's supposed to originate, say when we are under the sun for too long, etc. Overthinking. So when we have body aches, what happens is, because it's so physical, no, we can feel it. We know it's a headache. We know it's a backache. So our focus then goes to aspects of our body instead of the cause of the anxiety. It's a distraction. Right. So for if a person is experiencing bodily anxiety, it's important to work with this person, work with this client to understand if there is something which is troubling them. Listen rather than advising. Hear them out. If around the time that the body ache started, was there something worrisome or disappointing which happened? Is how is their sleep routines? Usually with anxiety, sleep routines would have been disturbed. Right. So that's something that you can also do. And I always believe no matter what, exercise helps a lot, whichever age group you are, whether you're 2 years old or whether you're 90 years old with a cane, you can still exercise something or the other. And it's important you do that. Right. A healthy mind will lead to a healthy body and vice versa, both ways as well. How could we teach good and bad emotion to the children? Right. So I feel that picture charts with children actually work very well. Stories help very well. I think we've all grown up with moral stories, and we can also create stories where we talk to the children about how a girl maybe told her father that she's sorry and everything happened well after that. Whereas there was another child who hid information from the father and what happened there. So we you know, help them understand different emotions, experience it. Just a second. You're able to hear me? Okay. And I think at a very young age, it's important that children express all emotions, not just bad or good. Okay. We don't get that segregation to them at a very young age. That is something that they will come to figure out much later. They should be able to come to parents and talk about all emotions, whatever it is, right? At the same time, let's say a child is feeling irritated. As parents, it's important you label that emotion rather than ignoring the emotion. Let's say if the child is wants something and you're not giving it to him or her, like a mobile phone, okay? And you take off the mobile phone and the child is getting frustrated. He's not going to tell you, I feel frustrated with you at that age, right? But it's important for us to label it and say that, so I think you're getting a little irritated that you're not getting the phone. It's not a good feeling, is it? Right? But when for you to have the phone, you promise me that you'll do your work first, right? So when you finish your work, we'll give you the phone for a little while. You will do it and then you will feel good. So we label the feeling because children at a young age do not know what is a, they don't even know the names of a lot of emotions. So we have to label it. And with children, it's important to read their body language and understand what is going on with them as well. How can we help someone who is choosing maladaptive processes to avoid anxiety disorders? I think the best thing that you can do is, in the case of anxiety disorders, it's important that you address them or inform them that these strategies are not working before you tell them directly go to a new strategy, right? Let's say that every time there is an anxious situation, you find that a particular family member is only reacting by crying, right? If there's something which is very overwhelming, they tend to cry. That is what you're seeing them, which means that what is causing the anxiety, that is not changing. It is still there. This person is crying. That is their reaction. And it's not a healthy reaction. It is good to cry, but by crying, you're not also being proactive, right? So after crying, let's say the person then says, okay, I finished crying now. This is too much emotional for me to take. I'll deal with this later. So it's not only crying, but every time they cry, there's also procrastination. So when you observe such things, it's important to bring it to notice of a person and saying, see, I'm a little concerned because every time something becomes anxious for you, every time you become anxious, I see that you first tend to cry and then you tend to push away the work and the work doesn't get done in the process, right? Is there something better that you could do, better that we could work on so that the work gets done? Okay, because I'm sure crying is not a good feeling. And by procrastinating, you're probably building up the pressure towards completing the work at the last moment. So it's important you observe it and put a feedback to the person and help direct them towards more positive strategies. And I always believe that the more positive you are, the more specific you are in your feedback, the better. For example, with my clients, if I tell them at the end of a session, okay, before the next session, please go, be positive. Think positive and come. That is very vague feedback. Or if I tell them, please go be more active. Don't be lazy. Don't lie around at home. That's not specific. Or if I tell them, you know, for the last one session, two sessions, I've noticed that you're not okay. Even not okay, we don't know what, the client may not know what we are talking about. But if I tell them, you know, in the last two sessions, every time I spoke about your family, I can see your face going down. I can see you're reacting in this manner. Is there something that is worrying you? So when you observe, it's important you give them specific feedback and then ask them, can we do this better and provide something which is more adaptive? Okay, how do you overcome overthinking, right? The first thing to do to avoid overthinking is writing it down, right? When you write it down, that I mentioned that one thought can't become another thought. And knowing Indians, we don't like doing writing work a lot. So even this will stop, but as much as possible, write down your thoughts. The second thing is deep breathing actually helps, right? So when you inhale and exhale in a very slow manner, your body also gets relaxed. And overthinking is a state of tension. When you are tensed, your body will not be relaxed. No, it's opposite things. It's like telling a person who is crying, oh, you're so happy. It's not possible for two opposite emotions, or you can't be sleepy when your body is alert and awake. So when a person is overthinking, ask them to relax. So even putting down your shoulders, you know, like slumping your shoulders, relaxed posture, walking about a little, stretching, taking deep breaths can help calm your body. And we also sometimes distract our blood flow to the head by directing it into something nice. Like you can taste of, like if you like chocolates, you can take a bite of chocolate. So your energy goes there, your focus goes there. Or some people like sniffing a flower. In the US and all, they have these mints, which they have these inhalers, which you can sniff. Any grounding experience. Right. Recently, like people who practice meditation, mindfulness and all, they have a small pebble which they have in their pocket, in their hands. So holding it is like a grounding experience that I need to distract myself from there into something different. Right. So writing your thoughts, deep breathing helps. Like I mentioned, each of them have also a different strategy. Like prayer can help, for example, exercise can help. But you also need to understand that in the case of overthinking, these are just thoughts. It can't harm you, right? And it's going to be there only for a period of time. One of my friends wants to overcome the thought she had a crush on someone that it isn't important for her. She needs to focus on her studies and career. Okay, so there has been a past relationship or there's been a person that she likes, but now the focus has to be in something else. So this again comes with priority. So I'll actually give you an example here. So one of the clients I'm working with right now, she has this exact same concern where she is preparing for her CA exams, which are there in November. And she pushed her exam from June to November with the hope that in these 6 months, she gets extra time to work and do her best in November. At the same time, there is this dear fellow who entered in January and started distracting her after that. And from June onwards, things started getting a little shaky where he started to really like her. But from her side, she knew she couldn't take it seriously because her parents, they come from a very conservative culture and they've already started looking out for a boy for her. But she's not able to get this boy out of her mind. And at the same time, she's not able to focus on her CA as well. And she feels more guilty every day that more time goes towards thinking about the boy than actually working at her CA, at applying for a job, etc. So then we worked on, the only connect that she has with this particular boy is the mobile phone, especially during the lockdown. And that mobile phone is, I think, as a Christian, I would say it is the devil itself. Okay, that mobile phone is the worst thing that has happened to us. It can also work well, but right now it's being very, very distracting. So what we have worked on, the strategy is, we have helped her come up with a schedule, a realistic schedule on an everyday basis. So for about 3 hours in the morning, she studies. During the 3 hours, she can get 15-minute breaks in between. But during the 3 hours, her mobile phone has to be locked in a cupboard and the key is given to her mother. So she gets the key only during lunchtime. And even then, we have worked on how that she should not sit on her bed and use the mobile phone. She can do it anywhere else, on the floor also. And her study room has to be, study space should be separate from her living and her bedroom, all of that. Her study space should be very separate. And in her study space, she only should have things which talk to her about studies. And this girl likes playing the ukulele as well. So we have told her, in the study room, keep your ukulele. When you take a break, you can do that. And she likes writing. So whenever you take a break, you want to write, you write. But at the end of it, you come back to your work. Okay. And in the night also, when you go to bed, 11 o'clock, she has to put her phone in the cupboard and give off the key to her parents. And she also says she's very lazy. So we are using her laziness as her strength here, saying, because you're this lazy, you're not going to walk downstairs, go get the key from your parents, come up, open your cupboard, take out your phone. That it'll take more effort. So you work with the strengths of this person, but you cut off the distractions and you start scheduling. That will really help. At the same time, bring to mind what is your priority right now. If the crush can wait, you can always tell the crush also, if she's in touch, that I need to focus on my studies right now. I need a little space. Or I will only be able to message in the night. Give a schedule, give a structure, and try sticking to it as much as possible. Right. Did I miss out on anything?
I have a question.
In the first year, 8 years as a parent, we have behaved anxiously with them. So you don't have to undo it, but at any particular time. So even if the early parenting was not, say, very healthy, or even if you've had a lot of negative strategies being communicated to the children, the one thing which I've also found in working with children is children forgive more easily than adults. Right? They don't retain these kind of memories so long, especially when they're replaced by positive memories. So it's never too late to start reacting in a positive way to the child. Even if the child is, say, 10 years now or 11 years now, you need to start changing as well. And you don't have to point to the child and say, you change. the parent also needs to change, right? So you start reacting positively now. You start having activities which is fun together. I always say that with parents and children as a family, I always emphasize that one, you have productive time together as a family. That is where all of you are together doing your chores, doing your routines, all of that productive time together, right? Like budgeting, shopping, all of that. You also need to have productive time separately, which is where you are independently focused on your work, your career, your day-to-day routines, household, but independent work. And you have to have enjoyable time together, right? Where together as a family, you can come together for anything except academics and work stress and anything, something fun together, so that you create a healthy environment at home. So if that's not been done before, it's important that you do it now. And one of the things that really works is practicing gratitude and appreciation. We might, for example, let's say, even if I pray, I sometimes end up asking God for more than I show him gratitude for. We tend to say, I want this, I want that, I want that, but we don't show gratitude, right? Which can also happen in our everyday life where we don't show children that that even we as adults can be grateful for the smaller things in life. And they learn. Children are always learning from their parents, no matter at which age it is. So if it has been an unsafe or a negative environment earlier, gradually there can be a shift also. And there is no harm being open with the child and saying, this is something that we were doing before and I've realized it is not very healthy. So this time going forth, you and I, son and father, son and mother, we are going to practice healthy things. This is what both of us are going to do. Not just me telling you, it's going to be both of us as a team doing this together. So that will really help, right? So with respect to mental health also, like if any of you have any concerns, you can always get back to me. I'll leave my handle here on the chat. There are some resources which I've already collected about dealing with anxiety and dealing with depression, which is available there. You can definitely access that and you can send it across to anybody who you want. We will be doing a couple of sessions on parenting as well. And that's something that you could like connect with. If any of you is interested also, you could check out those resources.
Rachel,
so thank you so much for this opportunity. It was a pleasure. You're muted.
Can you hear me now? Rachel, am I audible?
Yeah.
Okay, I have a observation from your previous case study.
I can't hear you.
Seriously? Can you hear me now? Am I audible now?
Interesting.
Am I audible now? The audio is on. Not sure what happened. Can you hear me now, Rachel?
I think your audio is gone, ma'am. So you might have to type it out or log out and log in. Thank you so much for all your questions as well. If there are any further questions, you can definitely connect with me on my page. We have a Q&A day where any questions are answered as well openly. And you can also access any resources on that particular page. And on the same name as well, on the same name, which is Reach Out to Rachel, the YouTube channel is also there where all the resources are also uploaded as videos. You can access it. Is there any reason why you asked that girl not to use the phone on her bed? Yes. So then when you use the phone on your bed, what happens is a lot of people think that using the phone, They fall asleep watching videos. They fall asleep watching messaging someone. But what we don't realize is that the light from the phone causes us to be more alert. When there is light, there is alertness. And it's something so simple, but we still stare at that light and nobody uses the phone at this distance. No, we all use it here. So it's causing a person to be more awake, right? In fact, this girl would hold her phone, use it continuously till 1 o'clock. One of the boys and younger clients I'm working with, he was telling me yesterday that, ma'am, till 4 o'clock, I'm not sleeping. I sleep at 4 o'clock early morning. So I asked him, what are you doing till then? He said, I'm playing games with my friends, etc. So then I asked him, where are you doing this? He said, on my mobile. He lies on the bed at 11 o'clock and he's gaming on his phone till 4 o'clock. Now gaming is not something like playing cards. He's actively shooting people from 11 o'clock to 4 o'clock in the morning. He's going to be alert. You don't sleep and shoot people, no? You're going to be alert. So you're making your brain more alert and you're strategizing how to kill people. You're planning with your teammates. All that is making you feel awake. At the same time, this boy is saying, why am I not sleeping? Why am I not sleeping? It'll not work, right? So it's important that the bed is not associated with anything other than sleep. Especially even in PGs, hostels, I always tell people, don't lie down in the bed also and watch videos or anything. Do it everywhere else. Come to the bed only to sleep, nothing else. Don't eat on your bed, teach your children on the bed, don't do everything. The bed should be associated with only sleep, and definitely mobile phone is a big no in the night. If you use it in the night, also what happens is, our body is very tuned to that buzzing note of our mobile. Anywhere if it buzzes, we get alert. Anywhere that sound comes, we know it's our mobile. We are so alert to these notifications, the message tones, that it's a state of alertness always. And when you're alert, sleep cannot coexist in the body at the same time. Right? So even if you look at your pattern, no, I'm pretty sure a lot of people here, even if they don't admit it, pattern will be morning you get up, you'll reach for your phone, right? That addiction is there. You want to check your phone. You want to see if there are any messages that has happened, any calls that you have missed out. We always have this fear of missing out, but nothing is going to happen, right? Nothing will change in a matter of a couple of hours. So when you go to bed in that space, it's important that you don't have your mobile phone. I hope that answered the question.
Yeah, it did. Can you hear me now?
We still can't hear you.
Not sure what
happened. All right.
Yeah, sure. But thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for the opportunity. Thank you.